you can only discover purpose, your true purpose, mm-hmm. by knowing your Creator.
Yes.
And so we can start and say, mm-hmm. the first thing is to get into a relationship with your Creator.
Yes.
That will be the first step. Mm-hmm. Because if you don't know God, how are you going to hear from Him, mm-hmm. and discover your, yes. purpose? Yes.
Hello, and welcome to yet another edition of Saints and the Kingdom. We are delighted to have you, and we are delighted to be able to share with you our principles from God's Word that will help move your life forward. My name is Eric Kibuga, and together with me is...
My name is Susan Kibuga. I'm the Director of Administration at the Joshua Generation. Karibuni.
I am Esther Morakinyo, and I'm a trustee of the Joshua Generation. Karibuni sana. We'd really like to hear from you, even as the program continues, the airing of this program continue. Please feel free to write to us. The information for our media links are completely, they'll be on the screen as you are watching, and you can be able to write to us. Our telephone numbers will also be there. Please feel free to respond and let us know whether you have questions, whether you have comments concerning this program. We look forward to hearing from you.
And my name is Nii Morakinyo. I'm also a trustee at the Joshua Generation. And together with our wonderful team, we are going to continue talking about your God-given purpose. And today we want to talk of how to discover it and pursue it. Mm-hmm. I mean, purpose is not an event. It's mm-hmm. a journey.
It's a journey.
A life journey of, yes. fulfilling the purpose or the reason for which God made you.
Mm-hmm.
It's continuously unfolds. You discover mm-hmm. and you pursue step by step.
Yes.
And we had talked about the misconceptions that mislead people.
Yes.
And we have to be careful of the errors that mislead people out of purpose or can mislead you in terms of purpose. But we want to talk of the accurate way to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And we are talking of your God-given purpose, what God has ordained for you.
Mm-hmm.
And if God has ordained it for you, then I think the first place you need to discover it is from God.
Yeah. God,
you need to know God himself,
yes.
to hear what the manufacturer has to say. Was mm-hmm. it Dr. Miles Monroe again? I quote him a lot, but mm-hmm. we have to give credit where credit is due.
Mm-hmm.
He said, the true purpose for a thing can only be known if you go back to the one who made it,
the manufacturer.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He can tell the true purpose or reason,
yes.
for which he made that
mm-hmm.
thing.
Mm-hmm.
In the case of every human being on this planet, whether they know God, they don't know God, born again, not born again, God is the one who made them.
Mm-hmm.
Whether you are in Arabia, in Africa, in South America, in Asia, North Africa, Europe, God made you. And
yes.
he made you for a unique purpose. And if you want to know your true purpose, you have to go back to God, the manufacturer.
Yes. You know, the Bible tells us that in Colossians 3:3, we've read the scripture over and over. Please don't get tired of it. It's a scripture that is very, it says, "For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God."
Mm-hmm.
The Bible tells us also in Colossians, in chapter 1, in verse 16, and I'll paraphrase it. It says that all things were made by him.
Mm-hmm. him. Mm-hmm. All
that
things.
Means all things, including mm-hmm. ourselves.
That's Colossians 1:26.
Yes. Colossians 1:16. All things were made by him. Mm. And for him.
For him.
And the Bible says in verse 17, and all things consist by him.
Mm.
And so it's important to know that the reason for which we exist,
mm.
why are we here? Which is one of the greatest
yes.
questions.
Yes.
Every human being on the earth rather,
mm.
asks, why am I here?
Mm.
What am I doing on the earth? Because what it does, it gives you definition of life.
Yes.
Mm. It causes you to have enthusiasm for living your life. Mm. And no matter the circumstances, no matter the challenges, then you know that you're fulfilling the purpose for which you are intended to live on the earth.
You know, one of the challenges I see is where, you know, people look at going back to God as a manufacturer, as old-fashioned, outdated.
Mm.
We're in a day where people want quick, instant results, quick, instant information. I can Google it.
Mm.
And so one of the things you find is where people, I would be more comfortable going to others and asking, what do you think about me?
Yes. Mm.
What do you think I'm good in?
Yes.
What do you think I can shine?
Mm.
You know, what is more marketable?
Mm.
And so you find, but then that path will lead you to a place where people, after some point, you can only run so far on someone else's opinion.
Absolutely.
So you still, even in our 21st century, we must still go back to God.
Wow.
It's not old-fashioned, it's not outdated.
Mm.
Because at the end of the day, I want to live my life with the confidence,
this is God, the
manufacturer's will.
Yes.
This is my creator's will. I'm not guessing, I'm not chancing.
Mm.
I am in the accurate will.
You know, it's amazing that what you said has triggered a thinking in me. When you look at the book of Matthew 16, chapter 16, there's that conversation Jesus has with his disciples.
With the disciples.
Yes, and it's all about your revelation, personal revelation of what God is saying.
Mm.
And he asked them, who do men, other people say I am?
Mm.
And all manner of answers, some say you are one of the prophets, maybe Elijah, someone, you know. Then he goes to the real question. He says, now, who do you say?
That
you need to have a personal revelation of who I am, why you are following me.
Yes.
I mean, what are you doing here? What are you in purpose being here? And Peter answers, says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus gives credit for that answer and says, look, this didn't come by some genius, but it came because God revealed it to you.
Yes.
So it's very important for us to walk with revelation of God, what God has revealed to us. Others may confirm what God has revealed.
Yes.
Others, even if they say what we don't yet know, we should keep it on the shelf, hold it till God actually speaks to you. Because in life, you are going to be judged on, one of the things we're going to be judged is not only doing good and bad, but did I fulfill the purpose for which I was made?
Yeah.
We were sent to the earth for a reason. There's a scripture here in Ephesians 2 verse 10. It says, Ephesians 2:10 says, for we are his workmanship.
Yes.
He made us, like somebody molded us, created in Christ Jesus unto
good works,
certain good works.
Mm.
Good works which God has before time ordained that we should walk in. So God has ordained what you should walk in. So we just have to go back to him to get the script, like an actor, and act out what he has already ordained for us to do.
You know, for us to fully maximize our lifetime on the earth, you know, which is fulfillment of purpose, you can't do it without the manufacturer himself, because he knows best what you are made for. But the moment we remove God from the equation, then we begin to underutilize or abuse the very purpose that God has created us for. So we can't do it without the original person that came and sat and said, Susan, this is what God has called you to be. And so these are the instructions I'm giving you. This is how you're to live your life. I mean, if I'm going to use, this is my phone I have right here, if I'm going to utilize it to the best use, then it means I have to take time and study the manual.
Yes.
I have to take time and get the mind of the person that made this particular gadget.
Mm.
Otherwise, I will be here on earth, but not fully utilizing what the purpose for which was created.
So
you can't do without going back to God himself.
So that's what we are saying. What we are saying is the discovery of purpose.
Mm.
Because a lot of people have had, there is a purpose for your life. God has called you to fulfill purpose.
But don't get into the principles, the process.
How do I come into the place where I discover this purpose?
Yeah.
How do I know that God has called me? An example I like giving is this. Because we said here that your purpose is found in him. Your life is hidden in him.
Mm-hmm.
So there is not going to be any escape mentality.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
By asking other people or by trying to define it in your own way.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's the place where there must be a relationship with God and fellowship with God.
Mm-hmm.
We normally say this here at the Joshua generation. We say the strength of any relationship is fellowship. The level to which you fellowship, you commune, you have a walk with the person, will develop their relationship. And let me give the example. Somebody would say, But how will I hear the voice of God? And we know that God speaks in many ways. God can speak to you through the still small voice of the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit that is in you. God can speak to you through other authority, spiritual authority over your life. Men and women of God that are mature, that are walking with God, that they themselves hear the voice of God.
Can speak through the manual. Can speak through the Bible.
The Bible, definitely.
It's like the manual God gave to go with you, His product.
He can speak to you through various. But it's important. And somebody will say, but how will I know the voice of God? And I can say this. A parent and a child, they know each other's voices. There's a tone to which, you know, if you have had a child or if you have children, and even if you don't have, I can give this example. Any parent that has children, a bunch of children are playing outside, maybe from the neighborhood. And the child of this particular parent begins to cry or shout. You will see the mother or the parent go out because they know the voice of that child.
They can distinguish.
They can distinguish the voice of their child.
And it's the same the other way around. When a child is inside the house and hears voices outside of adults, he can tell his parents' voice because of fellowship. And I want to bring it somewhere now. So then, can we say that you can only discover purpose, your true purpose, by knowing your Creator.
Yes.
And so we can start and say the first thing is to get into a relationship with your Creator.
Yes.
That will be the first step. Because if you don't know God, how are you going to hear from Him and discover your purpose?
Yes.
Because it's possible for somebody to be on this earth, do something that may even be good.
Yes.
Some good work. Please men, serve men, but you didn't really fulfill your purpose.
Yes.
Exactly.
It's possible. Just like I always say, when an exam is written, you are graded based on your answers to the exam the examiner gave you. But if you write your own questions, even if they are more difficult than that of the examiner, and you put your questions in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin, nobody in the class can answer them, but you can answer them.
Yes.
Okay, you wrote those questions. No, even if you got them all right, the examiner is not going to give you those marks. He's going to fail you because you are in disobedience. You did your own questions. So we have to be careful likewise in life that we don't answer, we are not doing our own questions. We are fulfilling His purpose. God is the examiner. In eternity, He is the one going to examine everyone. So you want to be in step, in line with Him, aligned, in sync.
You know,
you want to please Him.
You know, as you're talking about having your own purpose separate from that of God, one other thing that many times can also fool many people and not and make them not go the way of seeking God through relationship is where people begin to justify, but what I'm doing is for a noble cause. What I'm doing is good. And so many people interpret, I mean, if I'm doing something good, are you telling me God is not behind it?
The needs have been met.
It's, it might be humanitarian. Meeting humanitarian
and yet it may be a product from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil.
Actually,
both the good and the evil side of that tree were bad. Both, whether you eat the good or the evil side of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, it gets you out of your garden, your place of purpose. And it gets you out. That's why the Bible says there is a way that seems right to a man, but the end is death in eternity. Very important. Very important. So it's important to still go to God, eat from the tree of life. Because when we say, then which tree do we eat? From the tree of life. Let your inspiration come from God. Let it come from
life
God. That's the life of God. Let it inspire your dream, inspire you. And that's why you need to go to God and first enter a relationship with God. And first get to know Him.
So that relationship is the first thing. And in case you are a believer, and you say, I've been a believer for 15 years, I've been a believer, a born-again believer for 10 years. I don't know how to hear the voice of God. We will say something here. Even your ability to hear the voice of God is very much connected to your walk of obedience. You know, the level to which you obey God is the level to which you become more and more sensitive to the leadings and the promptings of the Holy Spirit. The Bible says that them that are the sons of God, they are led by the Holy Spirit. And that's why we are saying that it's not just knowing that you're born again and then doing what it is you feel like doing in your own eyes, you know, the wisdom of your own wisdom. So we are talking about the wisdom that comes from God. And there are steps to it. It's a journey.
And I think that's one of the places people want to take shortcuts. The church now is no more wanting to go by what the leading of God. Mm-hmm. We are trying to find out
no
of carnality.
Yeah.
Yes, it's no longer popular. Out of carnality, yes. We don't want to be led by the Spirit.
Yeah.
We now want to find other ways. So we are jumping into the secular ways of what the secular are calling purpose.
Yeah. Yeah.
And a lot of what in the secular and the world they are calling purpose is not God-given purpose. It's not accurate.
So the world has become a model for the church.
Yes, which is unfortunate.
And which is a very unfortunate thing. And so a lot of people are led astray.
What the world calls success may not be success in the eyes of God. In Joshua 1:8, he says, you will make your way prosperous and have good success. Joshua 1:8. There is a good success. So there is a good success when you accomplish what God wants you to accomplish. When you accomplish what God has ordained before for you to accomplish. That's good success. But you can do some other things that look successful, but in the eyes of God is not. You do these great works on the earth, but you don't even know God. So you die on this earth after doing those great things. Men clapped for you. But when you die, you get before God, you are not a success. You are a failure. You go to hell. That's not so good success. And that's why the Bible says there is a way that seems right to man, but the end thereof is death. And God's in Luke, the book of Luke, he says some things are highly esteemed amongst men, but not in the eyes of God. So a believer has to be in Christ, has to be very careful. Don't let us look for shortcuts that quick get rich thing people are doing. Let's go back to God's way. There is process, which is good for you because it also develops you, prepares you to handle what God has ordained for you across the journey of purpose.
And the need to the need to spend time with the Word of God, which are the basic principles.
That's one of
life.
The principles.
You know, it's unfortunate that we have taken time to read very many secular books. We've taken time to read books that have nothing to do with our own call and all that. And one of the things is go back to the Bible, because what the Word of God does, it familiarizes you with the voice of God. And the Bible says the sheep know the voice of the shepherd. So how do you get to know whose voice is who? Spend time with this Word, because it is God who inspired this Word of God. So as you take time to read it, you see principles, you see people's lives, the Joseph, the Daniels, you begin to study and say, oh, there's a pattern in how God speaks. And before long, you realize that when God speaks to you, to what Pastor Esther was talking, Reverend Esther was talking about, you begin to walk in obedience because you know the voice. But the moment we detach ourselves from study of this Word, then the truth is we become malnourished because we are not able to pick out the Spirit of God.
So this Word of God we are saying is like a manual. The same way a product like my phone came with a manual that instructs me how to use the phone, where to use the phone, when to use the phone, under what conditions, what it can do or not do. God also sent each human being with a manual. The manual is the Word of God, the Bible. And it shows us why he made man, the general purpose for man, and that same Word of God will help you even discover your unique purpose together with the Holy Spirit he has put in you. And the Word of God shows you how best you function. It shows you some general principles about life, the ways of God, how God thinks, that will guide you in discovering and pursuing your God-given purpose. So familiarity with the Word, ability to study, like the Bible says in Timothy, study to show yourself approved. A workman, you see, fulfilling purpose, that need not be put to shame, because you can rightly divide the Word of truth. We must come to a place where we get to know the Word, able to divide it. It brings us into that intimacy with God, where we can know God, know His mind, His thoughts, which will help us towards the journey of discovering purpose.
The Bible says that the Word of God, it is spirit and it is life. There is no day or no hour or no minute you will sit down with a situation that you're facing that is confusing, and you say, you know what, let me go to the Word. Let me sit with the Word of God. And you begin to read the Word of God. There is no time when you're reading it that the spiritual atmosphere in you inside does not begin to change. Because the Word is spirit. The words that I'm speaking, you cannot hear them. But they're having impact on your life.
You can hear them. You meant to say you cannot see them.
No, I said you can hear them, but you cannot see them. But they're having impact. So you are hearing, but you're not seeing them. But what's happening? What's going on your inside that there is some impact? It is what the Bible says, they are spirit, because they are in the spiritual, and then they are life. That life there, if you will allow me, is the Greek word zoe, which simply means the life of God, the God-given type of life. And when you sit with the word of God, something in you begins to happen. Something in your spirit man begins to change. You come into a place where you're more persuaded of the will of God for you.
You know, somebody said something once, and it's very important that on the journey of purpose, it's just like the journey in life. There are three major instruments you use in life when you are going on a journey. One is a map. One is a navigational tool. The other is what we call landmarks. Landmarks. And I think in the same journey of purpose, we have these three kind of instruments to use to help us.
Yes.
Where the word of God is like the map.
Yes.
The word of God is like the map. It helps you. And then the Holy Spirit, who is the other person that is important for us to say, because we've spoken about the word of God, it's like a map. It helps you. Every Christian should have that map. It guides you. Then the other one is the Holy Ghost, who is like the navigational tool. The Holy Ghost is there, just like how you use your GPRS today to navigate. In those days, it used to be a compass. And that's why pilots, when they are flying a plane, they have so many tools. You see them to guide them. They use that because sometimes you wonder, how is the pilot finding his way? And then the third one is the landmarks. Landmarks like mountains. They tell you when you're going on a journey, rivers, streams, or if you're in a city, urban area, certain buildings, unique buildings. Those are landmarks. And that is a typology of what the Bible calls the ancient landmarks of fathers. People who have been there, they've walked with God. He also uses them to speak into your life, to guide you. They are the ones that God says, the multitude of counselors, there is safety. And that's the same thing we have. And I think when we come back, we'll talk more on this in the next part of this episode. But let's say, continue with the word of God. Can we say something there?
You know, on the word of God, sometimes one of the challenges that people have is, how do I get to know whether something is the will of God or not? We are talking about discovering purpose. And you know, the word of God actually is the will of God. In the sense that when you read the word of God, this is the mind of God being communicated to you. And so even when you have maybe a leading, you had a dream, or some people spoke to you, they gave you counsel, you need a standard measure to be able to gauge that what they had, what they said, what you dreamt, what you saw, any inspiration you got, that you can be able to compare it on a measure that does not move, does not change. And that becomes the word of God, because it's a constant that you can go back to it, and by reading it, you are able to tell, these are, like Pastor Susan had mentioned, Reverend Susan, they are predictable patterns. There are things you can see, because this is the mind of God. This is how God thinks. This is how God analyzes. And so wherever it is that you're trying to discover what is the will of God for me, the purpose of God, acquaint yourself with his mind. And his mind will show you, of course, the word of God will show you his mind, his thinking, his reasoning, his will. So that don't stay in a place saying, I don't know the will of God, and you're not spending time with his word. By spending time, you will understand his mind, his will.
And this is very important, because the more you spend time in the word of God, you get to know his kind of thinking, his thoughts. And every other leading, whether it's like we said, the word being the map, whether it's a navigational tool like the Holy Ghost, must align with the word of God. The Holy Ghost will not tell you to do things outside
contrary
to the word of God.
Same
with the ancient landmarks, who are like the fathers, leaders, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, other righteous men and women who are leaders, spiritually sound. They will not tell you to do something contrary to the word of God. I mean, if you are following ancient landmarks, even in navigating your way in a bush or somewhere, the ancient
landmarks don't move.
No, they don't move. They will always appear even on the map. It must be in line with the map. On the map, the same map, you see the bridge, you see the river, you see the mountain. So it's always the same. But we'll come back in the next episode to discuss those three and in detail, one after the other. And I think we are looking forward, and we look forward to seeing you next episode. And we hope we'll have a good time. Don't forget our social media platforms. We can be gotten on them.
On Twitter, GG Media Trust. You can follow us.
On Facebook, The Joshua Generation.
And then on website. YouTube as well. YouTube, we have the GG Media channel. And our website is thejoshuagenerationtrust.org.
And our phone number will be scrolling. Please get in touch. Tell us your opinion. Tell us comments. Ask questions. And we'd like to air some of them. So we'll see you next episode. We're going to talk about the map, the navigational tool and the landmark in pursuing and discovering your God-given purpose. God bless you.
God bless you.